Hello, everyone, and welcome to Database Security Office Hours for December of 2021. It's our last office hours of the year, and I thought we'd do something a little bit different this month. We're going to talk about Zero Trust and the Oracle Database. And this is, as I mentioned, something different for us. We got a couple of questions about 2 months ago from a few DBAs who are working at organizations that are in the process of implementing Zero Trust. And they were asking, you know, how does this impact the Oracle database? How do I respond? What is this going to do to our life as a DBA? And thought that would make a really great topic for an office hour. So it took us a while to get there, but we're finally doing that this month. Now, you may ask, well, what is Zero Trust? It's not a product. It's not a something that you do in a week and be done with it. Zero Trust is a strategic initiative that if your organization is following a Zero Trust model, it's going to involve just about everybody, certainly everybody in information technology, but realistically, probably a lot of people throughout the organization. And the idea behind Zero Trust is to help prevent data breaches by eliminating the concept of trust. Now, Zero Trust was first developed by a guy named John Kindervag. And at the time, John was with Forrester, the analyst group Forrester. And this concept of Zero Trust was something that Forrester did a lot of thought leadership on. And if you were around in 2016, 2017, 2018, you may have run into the Forrester ZTK, the Zero Trust framework. John has since left Forrester and is now at Ontuit Cybersecurity, where he still talks and works a lot on the Zero Trust security model. Now, another way to look at Zero Trust, I'm going to quote from the CTO of MobileIron, a guy named Bill Harrod, is that a Zero Trust model is designed to ensure that the right people or resources have the right access to the right data from the right device under the right circumstances. And if you think in Oracle terms, what Bill is talking about is the concept of a trusted path to data. This is something that we deal with a lot in the Oracle world. Now, trust is a funny thing, and there are a lot of things in our environments that reduce trust. For example, the cloud can be said to reduce trust. If you move to the cloud, you move from an environment where you are in complete control of everything to one where you have a shared responsibility model with your cloud vendor. And so your cloud vendor takes some responsibility and you have some responsibility, but that means that you're giving up a little bit of control. So that may weaken your trust a little bit. You'll also often find that you have less visibility into what your cloud vendor is doing than when you were doing everything yourself. And so you may not know exactly how things are being done under the covers or if they're doing them the way you would want them done. Now, please don't get me wrong. I'm not in any way saying that the cloud is less secure. I think we have tons of statistical evidence showing that moving to the cloud actually improves security, that there's economies of scale involved. There's the focus that a cloud provider can bring to security that makes things better for security. What I'm saying is that naturally, as human beings, when we give up control, we have to give up just a little bit of trust. There's just no way around that. Another thing that can cause us to reduce our trust is concerns about the security of our supply chain. There have been lots of stories in the news over the past couple of years about supply chain vendors, and these are people who produce hardware, routers that come with compromises built in, motherboards with spyware built in. Some of our most trusted software vendors have been hacked in source code access, and we've lost a little bit of trust in the security of our supply chain. And so that drops our trust level down a little bit. Another area that's reducing trust is our ability to trust our own capability to respond. Let's face it, it's getting really hard to find experienced IT professionals, especially security professionals. And what that means is we all know that we're doing more with less, which is code word for not getting as much done in a lot of cases. And that lack of resources, that lack of experience just naturally means that we have just a little bit less trust in our ability to respond to incidents and to crises when they pop up. So all of these reduce trust to the point where you eventually get to zero trust, where your trust has gone down so much that you just can't afford to trust anybody. Now, another definition for zero trust, and one I think that I really like is here on screen, is that zero trust focuses on accessing resources in a secure manner, regardless of the network location, who's doing the access, the subject, or the asset, what's being accessed, and enforcing risk-based controls. And this is from the National Cybersecurity Center of Excellence. So our trust has been dropped down to zero. We now live in a world where there is zero trust, and we want to architect our security controls to respond to that zero trust environment. The threats that we're trying to address with our zero trust architecture are, just as a general thing, the threat of somebody disrupting our ability to carry on business. That could be a denial of service attack, it could be shutting down services, workload disruption, but we can no longer continue to function. The threat of someone corrupting our workload. In other words, somebody logs in and grants everybody a pay raise, or somebody logs in and changes our outgoing email addresses to say, I don't know, please buy stock in some silly thing, or please go to this watering hole and pick up a virus, if you will. But corrupting our information, the threat of stolen credentials, and you've heard us talk a lot in office hours about just how prevalent stolen credentials are in database breaches. And of course, the threat of insider issues, insider trading, insider malicious access to data, insider snooping on data. But these are the kind of things that get addressed with the zero trust architecture. Now, if you're involved in a zero trust project, it's not going to be just you. Nobody says to the DBAs, oh, we're going to go out and start a zero trust project and we want to start with the databases. That's not it at all. This is going to be a larger effort that involves a lot of people, but it is going to impact you. It's going to impact how you do business. Here's what you can expect. You're going to see an increased emphasis in your organization on some of the security fundamentals. There is going to be a lot more attention paid to network segmentation. You're going to see new firewalls come in. You're going to see new firewall rules come in. Now, I've been doing this for a little over 40 years now, and in 40 some odd years, I've never seen a case where somebody implemented a new firewall with new technology and new capabilities and didn't get it right the first time. I mean, it always works the first time. There's never an issue. Firewalls and firewall rules are just bulletproof. And if you believe that, I can sell you some land off the coast of Florida. Of course, there's going to be issue as we increase network segmentation. What this is going to mean to us as database professionals is we're going to see cases where all of a sudden access to our database is disrupted, where we're going to have to be able to trace network connections, where we're going to have to work with the network team to make sure that as they implement these better, stronger network segmentation with more powerful firewalls, that we can continue doing business. We're going to probably see a change in how we do our day-to-day work. A lot of us still live in an environment where we can SSH to the database server from our desktops as the Oracle user, do whatever we need to and be done with it and move on. Those days are rapidly drawing to a close. You're going to see almost everyone doing what we used to call bank-level security. You'll be hitting your database servers, but only after going through a Bastion host or a jump server. There's no direct access. This complicates things. Let me give you an example. I was on a call with a customer, a Zoom meeting with a customer a couple of days ago, and we were working on an issue with their Audit Vault server. And to do that, we had to get to their database firewall and look at a log file to see what the problem was. Well, we were on a Zoom meeting, right? Nobody goes anywhere anymore. It's not like I'm actually on site with the customer. Okay, so in order to get to the database firewall, the person I was working with had to drop from the Zoom meeting, open up a VPN to a Bastion host. From that Bastion host, they could then get to the database firewall. get the information that they needed from the database firewall, move that into a separate server where the file could be inspected, move that to their laptop, and then we could look at the log file. But what would normally have taken just a few minutes wound up taking like 15 or 20 minutes because of the network segmentation and the requirement to use a jump server to get at the data. This is just the way life is going to be. Things that were easier before may take a little bit longer now. But the benefit of this is a lot less chance we get hacked. This type of environment with the network segmentation, the requirement to go through jump servers, really does mitigate a lot of risk. You're probably going to see an increased focus on identity management and identity governance. So you may see that you're going to start using things like privileged account managers to log into the database server if you're trying to get in as a SysDBA user, if you're trying to get to the Oracle account to look at log files, that you're not just going to be able to log in casually as Oracle because these are all going to be more tightly controlled. We all work from home now, or many of us work from home now, and what you're likely going to see is an increased focus on device management and trying to control which devices you're able to connect with and what software is on those devices. We see this here. I have certain requirements on what I have to have running on my laptop before I can connect into certain portions of the network. You're going to see an increased focus on encryption, encrypting data at rest and in motion. And these are just good fundamental security practices. There'll be some people who are listening to this, particularly those of you who work in financial services, who are going to say, we've been doing all this stuff for years. Yes, you have. The rest of us are coming up to what you've been doing for a while now. You're going to see an increased emphasis on data inventory and on knowing where your sensitive data resides, how much sensitive data you have, what types of sensitive data. And the reason you're going to see this is part of Zero Trust is asset management, data asset management, knowing where your data assets are and making risk-based decisions on how you're going to protect that. Whenever you do a project where you start creating data catalogs and sensitive data inventories, it quickly brings to light that you have a lot of cases where you are retaining sensitive data that you don't actually need to have it. And that's particularly true in test and development environments. So you can expect as part of a zero trust framework, you are going to be asked as database professionals to try and remove sensitive data from your test and development environments. Okay. You're going to see more access, you're going to see more emphasis on access controls and trying to drive down the least privilege. If you don't need to be doing things as SysDBA, you probably aren't going to be doing them as SysDBA. You'll be logging in as just a regular DBA or maybe even a junior DBA, somebody with less access. A basic concept of zero trust is that we limit access to only what is needed for the job being done at the time the job is being done. And we review that access periodically to make sure it's still appropriate. We also want to make sure that access is determined by looking at everything we can see about the client identifier, not just the authentication, but how they were authenticated, what program are they running, what network location is making the request, anything we can check from a behavioral and environmental standpoint. You're going to see more focus on monitoring what's going on. Zero trust, a lot of zero trust is about understanding how data usage flows and the patterns in which data is accessed. And so you'll see monitoring at the network level. You'll see monitoring of clients, of workloads, of people, more focus on audit policies, audit data analysis. We're all going to become a lot more familiar with the database's audit capabilities. Now, when we talk about zero trust, this is a marathon. It's not a sprint. You're not going to do all of this stuff in a day, a week, a month, probably not even in a year. Your zero trust initiative is more than likely going to be a multi-year initiative. I won't even call it a project. It's going to become a way of life that changes the way that you work for a long time to come. All right, you're on board. You don't have a choice. Your organization's doing it. You're a good soldier. You're on board with zero trust. What should you do? From a database standpoint, driving out trust is really not that much different from the way we always talk about securing a database. It's just a slightly different slant to it. So just as we always do, we're going to look at our database configuration and make sure we're configured well. We're going to take steps to minimize the attack surface, minimize what can be attacked. We're going to encrypt our data at rest and in motion. We're going to move towards the strongest authentication we can manage to adopt without paralyzing operations. We're going to control access to data, and we're going to monitor activity in our database. Now, here's the key thing. You have to do it all. If you leave out one piece of this puzzle, then you leave the bad guys an open path into your database. Okay? So, driving out trust. Don't trust that you're going to configure a system properly and it's going to stay that way. Configuration drifts, and we know that configuration drift is often responsible for systems being compromised. As we go through each of our little puzzle pieces here, you're going to see a blue line that says relevant utilities, features, services, products. These are the Oracle pieces that relate to assessing configuration and detecting drift. Some of them are free. Well, some of them are included with your database. Some of them are extra cost. I don't care for the purposes of this. We're just giving you an inventory of what you might use. You are likely to use database security assessment tool to assess your configuration. If your database is running in the Oracle Cloud, or if you're using DataSafer on-premises, possible you're doing that, you'll use the security assessment functionality of DataSafe to help you keep your system configured and detect drift. If you have Enterprise Manager's Database Lifecycle Management Pack, there is a feature of that called the Configuration Dashboard that will allow you to do something similar. Assess your configuration, make sure that you're where you need to be and not drifting away from it. Don't trust your network to keep your database secure. Everybody has network security. Part of zero trust is you don't trust anything to do what needs to be done to keep your system secure. You always assume there's going to be a failure. So assume the attackers are already resident on your network. Assume that they have already subverted those controls and they are coming after your database directly. That means you want to reduce the surface that they have to attack. You want to minimize the points of attack for them. For a database, this generally falls into two different categories. Your non-production environments, you are going to remove sensitive data from them using tools like Enterprise Manager's Data Masking and Subsetting Pack or DataSafe's masking features. For user entitlements, you are going to use things like the Database Security Assessment Tool to try and identify overprivileged users. You're going to use DataSafe's user assessment, which will help you identify overprivileged users and detect drift. You can use one of the really cool features in Audit Vault and Database Firewall that we don't talk much about, entitlement monitoring and reporting and drift detection for entitlements. And you'll use a feature that we introduced in Oracle Database 12c called privilege analysis. The first three, Database Security Assessment Tool, User Assessment, Entitlement Monitoring, they tell you what privileges a user has. Privilege Analysis tells you what privileges the user has consumed while you were monitoring. So in other words, one tells you what people have, the other tell you what they use, and if you look at the things they have, they don't use, these are good candidates for removal. Don't trust that your storage, your backups, and your exports are protected. Assume the attackers are going to try and gain access to those. Encrypt your data in motion and at rest. For in motion, we offer two types of encryption, native network encryption, transport layer security network encryption. Both have their advantages and disadvantages. For data at rest, our solution is transparent data encryption, part of advanced security. And of course, whenever you encrypt, you also have to manage your encryption keys, which means key vault. Don't trust passwords. And I'm going to say that like 20 times. Don't trust passwords. Don't trust passwords. Don't trust passwords. Passwords are awful. We all use them, but they're awful from a security standpoint. So wherever you can, get away from the use of passwords, certainly passwords that are persistent, where you use the same password over and over and over again, and especially if you're using the same password for multiple systems. Separate your database users, your database accounts, into different categories. Some of them, the default accounts, the super user accounts, root, sysdba, Oracle, try, if you've got a privileged account manager, to drive those into being used through the PAM solution. For your named DBA accounts, wherever possible, go to multi-factor authentication. Your database supports strong authentication with Kerberos, certificates, Radius. Look into using that. For your end users, if you've got people logging in directly to the database, try and do the same thing. Kerberos, certificate, multi-factor. A little bit lower risk than DBA accounts, but still important. For service accounts, application service accounts particularly, you may not be able to strengthen the authentication to use multi-factor or stronger authentication, but you can use things like Database Vault to look at those accounts and make sure they can only be used through the trusted path. Now, here are the features, utilities, things you can use for this. Password profiles. Password profiles in the database are amazingly strong, and a lot of capability that we often don't use to make our accounts authentication more secure. In 19.12, the July release update for 2021, we introduced the gradual database password rollover feature. That was a new feature in 21C that we backported. Great for working with service account passwords. In 12C, we introduced centrally managed users. Move that authentication authorization up to Active Directory. Database strong authentication, been around since Oracle 8, certificate-based authentication, Kerberos-based authentication, wonderful way to improve your security. Not too long ago, Oracle released the Oracle Radius adapter, which allows you to connect your Oracle database accounts to things like token devices and strong authenticators and mobile authenticators. So don't trust passwords. Don't trust that your users are who they say they are, that they're acting in good faith. Assume that your users are compromised and lock down their access to the minimum amount possible wherever you can. Now, when we talk about access controls, there are two general types of controls that we look at. There is something called process or policy controls, which is basically, I've got a policy that says you shouldn't do that, and if I catch you doing that, there will be action taken as a result of that. And there are technical controls where the system doesn't allow you to do whatever you're not supposed to do. Let's be realistic. Policy controls, process controls have zero impact on a malicious actor. You're not going to fire them. You're not going to slap them on the wrist and not promote them. They don't work for you most of the time, or they're just there to steal data. So wherever possible, emphasize technical controls over policy and process controls. Lock down your sensitive data so that access is minimized. Things you're going to use for this: privilege grants, role grants. Don't forget secure application roles, one of the lesser known but really more powerful database features. Database Vault, trusted path enforcement, privilege user controls, great way to lock down access. Virtual private database, real application survey, real application security, fine-grained access at the row level, same thing with label security, and advanced security's data redaction to prevent proliferation of sensitive data columns. Don't trust that your technical preventive controls are going to be 100% effective. The bad guys have been walking around controls for a while now, and they're not going to get any worse at doing this. So make sure you're monitoring what's going on in your system. Make sure you can identify unauthorized activity. You're going to be working a lot with auditing. You're going to be working with tools like Audit Vault and Database Firewall or DataSafe auditing. And when you're auditing, here's kind of what you want to audit, just as a starting point. You're going to increase this and change it to meet your needs. But a good rule of thumb is always audit data definition and data control language. If someone's changing a stored procedure, if someone's creating a new user, if someone's granting DBA or select any table, you want an audit record of that. Everything a privileged user does should be audited. It's not an application. You're not worried about application performance for an audit record. If it's a privileged user doing it, there should be an audit record. If there's access to sensitive data from outside of the application, here again, This should be a rare thing. Audit it. From there, you may add more on, but this is a good rule of thumb. If you're not monitoring at least this much, if you don't capture at least this much information about what's going on in your database, take another look and figure out why, because this is kind of what I would consider to be the minimum. What's next? You are either at the point where you're implementing Zero Trust now, you're beginning this initiative, in which case, hopefully what we've talked about gives you a little bit to go on and you have some ideas about how you can help your organization's Zero Trust initiative. If you're not there yet, do a little bit of reading, do a little bit of homework. NIST came out recently with a great publication called the Zero Trust Architecture. It's 800-207. You can see the website here on your screen, or just do a search for NIST 800-207. It'll come right up. Now, before 800-207 was developed, the National Cybersecurity Center of Excellence had a draft paper called Implementing a Zero Trust Architecture. This paper is what became 800-207, but as often happens as papers go through revisions, there was some information that was lost as you moved from the draft or the legacy version up to 800-207. I still like the old Cybersecurity Center of Excellence document because I think it does a better job of explaining things from a business high-level environment. The NIST document dives really into details very quickly. You'll still find the CCOE document at their website. Take a look at it. If you have access to Forrester Research, remember, the person who came up with the concept of Zero Trust was a Forrester analyst, a really, really good one. And so there is a ton of Forrester Research that is valuable from a Zero Trust standpoint. Two of my favorite pieces of research are the Zero Trust Framework and the Practical Guide to a Zero Trust Implementation. If you do a web search, particularly for the latter one, chances are you will find some vendor who's got that paper ready to redistribute and give up your email address to get the paper. It's usually a good trade. Really good reading, really good things to work at. I hope that has been of some benefit for you. With any luck, you have a better appreciation for what Zero Trust is, how it impacts our lives as database professionals, what you can bring to the table to help your organization as they move down the Zero Trust pathway. Thanks again. It's been a great year in 2021. I look forward to seeing you all in 2022. Be safe, and we'll see you next time.